friends, welcome. The family's about to come in and get ready for the service. They'll be delighted to see all of you here. I do want to make sure that everyone has a program and everyone has an art booklet. So does everyone have those things? Okay. Wonderful. We will be, oh, one person here needs them over there.
Friends, good afternoon. Welcome. Funerals and celebrations of life are important things. They are individual things. Each of them are unique. Today we gather to honor and celebrate Margaret White Northrup, an amazing and dynamic human being. We gather in a place where only truth and honesty will do. And today we gather 3 years after her passing. There is no one right way to do a memorial service, especially one like this. But there is only one way that we can do it together, and that is to be completely honest with how you were feeling, with things maybe you thought you'd already dealt with the cherished memories that come back to you. I know as the family prepared for this service, it was amazing how emotions would suddenly emerge of things that were thought to have been already honored. And so as we begin today, I invite you simply to be who you need to be and express whatever emotion you need, for in a moment like this, only truth and honesty will do. And now, before we start, will you take a deep breath in and let go of everything that has come before on this day? Take one more breath and let go of everything that is yet to be done. And simply be here. Amen. May the peace of Christ be with you all as we gather here in this sacred place to do the final things that human hands and hearts can do for Margaret White Northrup. For here we come to gather with her beloved children, with Anne and Ellen, Dan and Ben and Sarah, with Gordon, who has gone before, and with the whole extended family, both those of biology, of marriage, and of choice. We gather to celebrate a life beautifully and forcefully lived, to mourn the loss that we feel, and to bathe in the truth of our God and our faith, who is with us now and in this very breath. As we gather, we do not do it alone, but rather in the sure hope of God's promise, who says to us, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my hand." We gather remembering the words of Jesus, who said, "I am the resurrection and the life. All who believe in me, though they die, yet shall they live." And finally, we remember what our brother Paul said, that there is nothing in all of creation, not life or death, no height or depth, no angels or demons, nothing we have done or could ever do, nothing that can separate Margaret or us from the love of God in Christ. Friends, my name is Brent Damrow, and on behalf of those who call this place home and the Northrup family, I welcome you here to the First Congregational Church. Here in this church, we always start worship in two things. First, we want to extend an extravagant welcome to you, to anyone who comes through the doors, no matter who they are, who they love, who they vote or cheer for, what kind of body they have, what kind of faith, if any, they claim, what kinds of doubts they carry. Because here we believe that each and every one of us are God's beloved children. Maybe put this way that Margaret might have approved of. Each of us are God's love song, just waiting to be sung. So today, know that you're welcome just as you are. May this be a place of safety and peace. Speaking of peace, the second thing we do is we always pass the peace, for here we understand that peace does not mean to be in a place where there is no sorrow or stress, but to be in the midst of all life can throw at us and still have peace in our hearts. So before we do another thing, would you rise to your feet as you are able? We're going to teach you a way of passing the peace with one another, a way to give peace away and receive it. It's a way that we have learned in these recent years. It's using sign language. I want you to put down everything you have and take your left hand and hold it out. The sign for peace is take your right hand on top, flip it over, and ground it. That's peace. Be with is a little easier. You just bring it together. You is even easier. You just simply cast it out. Now there's one more thing before we share it you need to learn. That is the "and also with you" part. And that is the most fun part. You take your thumb in, your finger out, and you just take what you've received and throw it around the room. So here's what I want you to do. Turn towards the center aisle, and let's do this together. Ready? Peace be with you. And now will you share it with one another? And now, friends, just remain on your feet for a moment longer, and will you join your hearts and minds with mine in prayer? Holy and loving God, be with us now as we gather in this holy space to handle the mysteries of life and death. Send your spirit deep into our hearts. Lift up friend and family that we might, with courage and faith and love, remember our sister Margaret. Be with us that we might recall treasured memories, hear ancient stories, sing beloved hymns, and bathe in the river of your healing love. God of all that was, is, and ever will be, heal our human hearts made heavy by sorrow. Through the veil of our tears and the silence of our emptiness, assure us again that eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor human imagination envisioned what you have prepared for those who love you. We pray all these things through the holy and the wonderful, and let us say together, Amen. Our first hymn can be found in your pew hymnals. It is number 469. Tracy's going to play it through once, just in case for some reason it's unfamiliar to you. But let us make a joyful noise. Will you remain on your feet and join in the call to worship led by Mark Bachman? It is printed in your bulletin.
Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary.
Praise him in the firmament of his power.
Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet.
Praise him with the psaltery and harp.
Praise him with the timbrel and dance.
Praise him with the stringed instruments and horns.
Praise him upon the loud cymbals.
Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals.
Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord.
Praise ye, Lord.
You may be seated.
The Spirit is here, amen. Speaking of Spirit, I'm going to invite Ann and Dan to come up. And I want to tell you about, as they come, a Spirit. So much heart, so much love has gone into what you are about to experience, and so much time. And it is a gift of beauty, and I look forward to seeing it. Come on up.
So happy to see you all here that I can hardly contain myself. Margaret died in June of 20, Oh, I'm sorry. Thank you. Thank you. To see through Margaret's eyes, my son Nick's words. Margaret died in June of 2020 at the beginning of the time of COVID. And since then we've been sorting through, trying to make sense of the disorder of the enormous quantity of stuff she left. What to keep, what to ditch. There's just really an odd disconnect between the disorder she left and the brilliance of her ability to create and recognize systems in the world. It's really extraordinary. But in the midst of all that stuff, we found a beautiful prize, a big stack of artwork that we had never seen, that she just put away in the attic. And I want to show you some of those drawings. These two are on the front cover of the little brochure of her artwork that Diana Gruberg made. If we look at, so that's this, and if we look at the drawing on the right, you see Margaret painting a picture of her favorite tree, which was a pear tree that had red on one side and gold on the other side had been grafted. And she would stare at that tree, and those of you, you all knew her, and the way that she could just be stopped dead in her tracks by a beautiful bouquet, and the light of winter, which you see on the, I think it's the back cover of the program, you see her staring into the winter light. That was so just completely, that's what she did, you know. So on the right, so I made a photograph of that, and I set her up to paint it. I wanted to see what kind of painting she would make with that. I thought she was mostly enthralled by the red versus gold part of it, but then I looked more closely, so I asked her to take a picture of what she saw, and the picture on the back cover of, I guess it's your, is it your program or your, or the drawing handbook, of this tree, which is all gold, she photographed it by her choice with the sun behind. And I just want you to see how extraordinary the light is. It's really kind of ecstatic. I was very surprised when finally I kind of went through all of these things to prepare the talk and found this extraordinary photograph that was nothing like what I thought it'd be like. I think that's the ecstatic light that she saw in the world multiple times. And it's just very special. And I think really that expresses her belief in God. She was a very religious person, but she honestly could not stand the dogma of the Catholic Church. I was in church, Episcopalian church with her one time, and the Nicene Creed practically drove her out of the building. She sighed and, it says there's no health in us, and that was the thing that she just couldn't stand. So anyway, so God was that light, I think. It was, God is the organizing principle of the world. God is the systems that she recognized everywhere. The way the calendar has to adjust to the seasons and the planets and the moon and the stars. And what are the other systems she was good at? Well, drawing, the systems of bodies moving through space, many different maps, geometry she was really good at. Maps, she would draw you a map. How do I get from here to there? You'd get a triangle, elongated triangle that was like perfectly proportioned to the actual, if you were looking from an airplane view. And I'd be like, how am I supposed to find my way with this? But that was the way she saw. She walked into a room. She had never seen a Rubik's Cube before. It was new at the time. She walked in, Nobody's paying any attention to her. She walked over to the table, she picked it up, and she made it all yellow on one side and all red on the other side. She just solved a Rubik's Cube like lickety-split. What? You know, some of these things are really surprising that anybody would know this. There's other amazing things about her. She was extremely athletic, which a lot of you knew her when she was old, when she was young. She was one of a family of eight, and she really just couldn't stand the hubbub in her household. So she chose a bedroom on the second floor attic, in the attic, you know, like unfinished kind of space. And she didn't like going down the stairs through the kitchen because it was the hubbub of the kitchen, right? So she would jump out the second floor window. And she told me she thought she shortened her legs because she did that habitually by jumping out the window just to get in and out. Was like, okay. You know, she was very athletic, extra athletic. It's amazing. So they brought her, her high school brought her to a track meet one time in the neighboring town. And they lined them up, you know, ready, set, go. She took off, but she took off fast. So, like, she noticed that there wasn't anybody around her, so she turned around and looked to so that she could, you know, see what's going on. And she decided she must have made a mistake because she had really kind of a low self-opinion. And so she waited for them to catch up, figuring that that was the right thing to do. You know, so she's like a little out of it. She said to me a number of times, you know, I was kind of a dud, you know, so that's how she felt about it. But, you know, she was extremely great also. So now are you seeing, so this is the way she grew up on a farm in Holliston, Massachusetts. So this is her father and brother, Donnie, cutting a log, the same way Mari, Ev, and Dave cut that wood at their wedding. I just want you to notice the line, the way she draws. It's kind of athletic, actually, I feel. So she, like I say, her sense of systems, bodies moving through space, was very accurate. She didn't have to go in and like measure the head, make sure it's 8 heads tall. That was not necessary. You know, she could feel that and see it very naturally. And she could also see in the gesture, she could find a line and just take that one line and like play with it and show you how the body was moving through space, the posture, maybe the, even in this one here with a, on the left, where the front guy is sawing, maybe he's the older one, her father, you can kind of see the stiffness in his body a little bit. You know, she had a kind of empathic way of seeing people also. Then on the right, you see the children playing with the horses in the wagon. And it's just the energy in that charcoal line that I really wanted to show you here. I wanted to show you all the drawings, actually, but she just didn't keep them very well in the hot attic, drawn on newsprint, most of them. They're like deteriorating. They're very delicate. So it just was too risky to bring them. So that's why we're showing you the slides. In this next slide, I'm not giving Daniel his proper signals, you see on the left an odd character, a little solitary person here with a beret clasping their clothing like this, you know. So she had a love of odd characters and would draw constantly on the train. She took the train to art school. She entered art school right after high school. And on the right is a drawing of people on the train. Just whatever was in front of her, she was drawing it all the time. And it's that same energetic light line. Notice how the collars connect these fellows. You know, they're like in this kind of rhythmic way. On the next one, she's in art school. She's got the figure drawing class. And she's like really rapidly putting these all in, overlapping and crowding on this one page. And she is exploring the curves of the body. You see, like, what's the rib cage doing? What's the, you know, what are the hips doing? Like, that was something that she just immediately understood. You know, it wasn't anything anybody had to teach her. It was, you know. Anyway, the one on the right shows her spatial understanding, but also her interest in character. These characters here, you know, and who are they? And how did she turn her head? And what's her hair do? You know, all of that you know, interested her. She didn't have that same doubt in her art at all that she had had in her racing. You know, she knew where she was going with it. She knew she could do something that she, you know, was really good at. So the again, it's the sureness and brevity of the lines that she uses, and then the way she plays with them. So the on the left, I love this picture of the girl from the back. The pose is really kind of subtle. So she's got her head slightly to the side. This shoulder's a little up. You know, this hip's a little up slightly. You know, but and she's describing all that, but she just gets fancy with it every once in a while, and the line starts to like live on its own. So I guess that's why I like this so much. And next to her is a cat, very, very briefly, you know, drawn in a different mood. It isn't that, you know, edgy, slightly edgy thing. It's just the, you know, the languid curves, the way a cat, you know, our dad always commented that cats, like they're like Benjamin, for instance, or Margaret, like they're like completely languid and then they leap up and start to perform. You know? Okay, so then in the next slides, you see her, these are like kind of traditional art school drawings, like you really see the form in space. Like you see the cubic form of the shoe where you've got the side of the shoe and the front of the shoe and the back of the shoe and each one is taking its place. And then, but she's very good at combining her line and edges with the tones that flow around so that really, you know, like you really almost believe that's a shoe. This is on the right, interestingly. This is a one of her friends at art school, Helen Clavia or something like that. She had two pictures of her. The first one is mopey, you know, and honestly, I thought it was pretty wishy-washy. But this one is the same woman with all her young beauty. She's still, it's called the spirit of Helen Clavia. This is still, you know, someone very spiritual and somewhat sad, but now, you know, bodied out in this three-dimensional looking strong drawing makes a lot more impact. And these next two are just such master. Masterpieces, I think. Oh, the softness and accuracy and the spiritualness and feeling of the one on the left, the portrait, and then the magnificence of, as you see, of the standing nude. She was a star. But she had her dark side. And so this is the one on the right is a self-portrait. It says, as I see myself, really? That's nothing like her in my mind. But it's like the Snow White witch. Somebody recently pointed out it's just like that witch. And then that's her brother next to her, brother Joe, the next younger. She was kind of in charge of him a little bit. And he had, he was diabetic from two childhood illnesses at once. I think it was pneumonia and chicken pox or something. And he never could eat dessert. Now they had dessert with every dinner. You know, they had pie and cake. And Margaret told me she felt that they really should not have had dessert if he couldn't have it. So he was always sad, always felt left out. And, you know, so that was, but she had a special feeling for him. She had a very strong empathy that you see in a lot of her work with her odd characters, you know. Anyway, so he was continually deprived. No one listened to Margaret. in fact, they had little faith in her judgment and ability at all. They wouldn't let her make pie because she might ruin it. You know, they wouldn't let her buy her own shoes. Aunt Helen had to go with her, which cost 2 bus fares, and then she had to get shoes with cardboard soles. She told me this with a lot of aggravation. Anyway, you know, so many years before. These two, next two, I think the one on the left is Uncle Peter, who is Gordon, my dad's brother. Look at the softness of it, the curvy, like, grace of it, and the weight of his hair, and all the things that are incidental and, you know, and just his haircut, whatever it was, but also so expressive of his youth and beauty. And the one on the right, Mr. Sullivan, is his name, and his he's so different, right? It's a similar line in a way, but it's hard and staccato and sharp, his eyebrows, you know, and he's covering, and the gesture is very expressive too. So, you know, she just really had it all in a way. And, you know, and she could manipulate media to beat the band, you know, she just, anyway. The next two are very strong portraits. It's Mr. Sullivan again, now with a very skeptical look. And this other one isn't named the tonal portrait, but it's very strongly structural. It's got color now, and the tone, notice just how she can get the media to just cooperate with whatever it is she's trying to show. We're getting the dark side a little bit in this next one, because World War II is coming up. And she's still riding the train, she's still going to art school, and the drawing on the left, where she's looking out the train, somebody is looking out the train window, but I'm kind of thinking Margaret is looking out the train window. And but she zeroes in on the hands, like the whole body and head, and everything is, she's like, she knows what she's doing. She doesn't have to give you every detail. And then the hands down at the bottom are standing out. That's the part, only part she focuses on or tells us anything really about. And the other one is a very anxious caricature or very quick sketch. And the asymmetry, I think, expresses the same kind of anxiety. And on the next one, you've got two soldiers, very beautifully and precisely drawn. I guess the soldiers were now appearing on the train. And so she's drawing them. Let's see now. I kind of lost my place here, let's see. Oh yeah, Gordon. The next one is Gordon. She met him in the music listening room at MIT where she was working as a draftsman. She joined the Army Air Forces. They wanted her to be a typist. She was the world's fastest, exaggeration, typist. She was a really fast typist, she told me. You know, she did not lie. She never, anything she told you she meant, there were no social graces about it. She told you what she meant. And so I believe she probably was a fast typist. But she flunked the test because she just couldn't stand the idea of typing for as work. So they put her to work much more appropriately as a draftsman. And Gordon had been working in the Signal Corps, in the Army Signal Corps, radar, and traveling around Europe. And they fell in love and started a family. Now, let's see, I think I've lost something here. Okay. The next ones, yeah, I guess I don't need to tell you where they were living and everything else. I'd love to. The next one are two very lyrical drawings of nursing mothers with their babies. Probably, she told me about going in for checkups at a city-run medical center in Chicago where they just made everybody wait for hours and hours and were just not very helpful. But these beautiful mothers and babies, I hope you can see the one on the left. How well can you see that? That's a very destroyed piece of paper that's on, but I think it's very beautiful. And again, that same lyricism in the line. So the next few are about children. And I think this one on the left looks like Benjamin used to look. I'm the oldest, so I remember how they looked as children. And so we went to Mexico for a vacation. Dad got stung by a stingray, and Daniel caught an enormous fish, and Ben was super excited about it. So this is Ben with a fish. This is just a pastel fish he drew much later, not at the time, but it just reminded me of the two of them, their glee about this fish. And this one you see now in pen, a little different media than usual, her very abbreviated and very sure, you know, way of working in line and tone, and sort of the experimental approach that she always had. And she didn't just like, you know, pick up a brush and make her usual drawing. She was always, you know, really looking for something. But she had a second dark period besides her somewhat on, you know, sadness in childhood. And this is a self-portrait of her as an adult. She was pretty glamorous looking. And she joined a dance troupe. Jan Veen was the name of this group in Boston. So that she, you know, became very moody after the birth of her fourth child, Benjamin. And I think it was because Dad was finishing his training, and it wasn't clear. She really felt she needed to go back to her family and reunite with them. They hadn't seen each other all this time. Nobody had the money to travel. And so I think the decision was made right about then. But it was a struggle for her. And actually, Ellen and I were sent off to live in Portland, Oregon for a few months to give her a little time not to be so busy and just to be with her baby. And so we were living with friends of theirs and going to school up there and everything. So the next two slides show you the next four, you know, one, two, three, four, that you're going to see are very powerful and dark and very curious and different from the rest of them. She does it through away form. Form no longer cares about that, and it's all emotion. I'm not sure why this boy is so sad, but my son's three-year-old told me, I had this up on the computer when he came up, and he said, "That's a sad boy." And it's true. And so I think maybe it was around the time we lost our dog Shady on the trip back across the country to Massachusetts. We were dragging a trailer. Shady was in the trailer, stopped at a stoplight. This is what she told me at the time. I think Daniel has a different story. She probably really felt so bad for Daniel. He probably, you know, he was the one who was most attached to the dog, I bet. Do you remember? Yeah. And the next two, I think, are her. To me, the one on the left really looks like her, even though it's totally distorted. But look at how expressive it is and how powerful. The one on the right with a skeletal look, looking up with this kind of skeletal three quarters. Anyway, so I think that's why, you know, they had to move back to Massachusetts at that point. But there's a sense of vertigo, kind of, in her abandonment of her attachment to space and form and really any connection to a consistent three-dimensional structure. And they're a little flat and, you know, they're doing their own thing. So that was a rough time. And then we moved back. That was amazing. We showed up on Aunt Franny's lawn with, you know, full camping regalia, and her kids came out and said, "Who are these people?" So, anyway. Then they got lobsters. The lobsters crawled all over the house. You know, it was just—it was an amazing time. But the next slide shows that this—you know—shows the change in mood when she moved back east, settled in, got the house. She's—you know—this is a drawing from art school, but I put it in to represent her new mood. And she started working on drawings from nature. And on more experimental types of things, using Japanese rice paper, which is very absorbent, so it does funny things when you try to, you know, it requires special control. Here, the first one is an apple, and she's experimental with it in several ways. Like, she loads the brush with two colors, then it's a Chinese brush, this pointy brush, very, very soft, that you can lay it down sideways and it'll give you two colors, that kind of thing. And at that time, I was teaching art, and I had a visiting artist. I invited her down to Chinese artist, Lily Ye, and I invited Mom down to take class with us for that week. And so she started that way. But I think she really, and the next one is similar, very similar. It's a tiger lilies. This is on normal watercolor paper, so it doesn't have that same, you know, bleedy quality. But you can see in that middle leaf, right in the middle of the composition, is three colors on one brush making this leaf. Anyway, so she can manipulate whatever you want in art. She can manipulate it. And so in the next two, this is a drawing of her hanging cactus, which I think Lisa may have given her. Lisa? And certainly took care of, probably, you know, rescued it many times from Margaret's inattention, I bet. But anyway, this is a very weird, soft, fibrous paper that runs unexpectedly. So you see these kind of halos of pink on the cactus. And, you know, and I think that's part of what she wanted. She wanted something where she could set up a situation and she could control it, and then something funny would happen. And I think that was kind of like, you know, that's kind of an act of God in a way. Like, you set the thing up, here's nature, here are the trees, and then whatever happens, happens. Like, the systems are all in there. And then there's the element of chance and life. So in the next two, it's a landscape on the left and a young pine tree on the right. And you can see her here also, that it's like she made the sky look heavier than the mountain. The mountain is pretty flat, but the clouds are really gathering in the sky, and not sure how much of the detail that you can see, but then in the same thing in the bank of trees down at the bottom, where the color is changing, not in necessarily a realistic way. And I think that she loved that element of chance. The one on the right, she toned the paper first in gold, then in green, then she drew the pine tree in graphite and white chalk. So she just really wanted to experiment and see what happened. This slide is a landscape drawing of a waterfall and a tree, right? You think. I think it's the waterfall on the way if you're hiking up Monument Mountain. It's a place she loved. It's a place where the rock breaks off sharply and into the cave below this rock. It's a very smooth rock. The water is falling over the edge, and then it goes, and it just becomes textured in this way. It does that. It looks like that. And then it lands on the boulders at the bottom, and there's a green tree, very delicate, growing through it. And then the foreground, you see that swoop? That's just like the hill there, so that's got to be it. And I feel like this whole experience of finding these drawings and going through these slides and hooking them up to events in my life and things she said to me has been such a revelation that it's been amazing.
As the choir returns to their pews, Ben, would you come forward and share our reading for today?
My mother was fearless and in herself, and you can hear, tell that she's really so much of a different person, and actually quite hard to understand. Many times in talking, and I thought when I was seeing the drawing of what Anne thought was a cat, I thought was a fox, but it had the absolute minimum to it, and that was part of how she talked. Almost like poetry, she would say the minimal, the absolute minimal, because she didn't want to lock you into one way, her way of thinking. You are a free person, and she was giving you something. So she was often very hard to understand. She did, though, in her love of nature was so profound, being outside to see a tree or even just appreciating anything. And we invited her for dinner and she would put something in front of her and she would just say, wow. So it was this appreciation that I felt like she taught me and I really appreciate it. She gave it to me. So that part of loving nature included the idea that everyone should be free and should be outside where nature really was, even though I know that I just see Dina there, that her mother Ellie thought that she was like a saint. You know, she would say that and my mother would get annoyed. Why, you know, this is like, that's not, you know, why would you say something like that? So in all of these things found around the house, I'm not sure if it was Daniel maybe who found this letter, which never got sent. But I'm pretty sure know what was going on with this letter is that it was a time when I was at the high school and I let her know that we weren't going outside, that we used to during the summertime, we had just gone, but it was getting later and we were not allowed outside of the building. We had, and some, this infuriated my mother, you know, the kind of, you know, she doesn't get angry. Maybe she never showed much anger. But she wrote a very angry letter, which never got sent. But if I read, I'm not going to read the whole thing of it, but because it's just, you might find it hard to understand. But the following for this. Let me just see what it says. But she starts off, dear Mrs. Day, and she has an important thing to tell her. Love may laugh at locksmiths, but bound people don't work well, and teachers would not feel free for their own respite. The year the school opened, although the fall, I was joyful that everyone had that lovely space for replenishing the spirit in our lovely autumn. When December, it came out that no one was allowed outside, I felt tricked and brokenhearted. When I told Mr. Wood, then principal, that even prisoners have their patch of blue, he said, are you one of those people who always have to have their own way? I said, I think it's God's way. So I had to draw up a petition and take it around. There were people who did not sign it. Some took convincing, most agreed and signed it. All but one clergy would have a copy in the back of the church on Sunday to be signed. It's very important to her. Dr. Campbell said, sounds like they're running a prison camp down there. Later, he said, those that couldn't take to the cafeteria were doing without lunch. That got my mother going. Margaret Drake said, let the kids do it. Pupils, being people who must learn responsibility, need to be given it and allowed, even encouraged, to learn from their mistakes. How do we live without breaks, sealed off from the hills from whence cometh our help. That was in italics. I don't want any binding on you either, Margaret Northrup. There she is. Thank you, everybody, for coming.
Anger, becoming, letters, development. In the Christian faith, we so often make the mistake of trying to find an ending when it is always about becoming. God's own name means always becoming. And in this service, we've gotten a sense of Margaret's own becoming, the development of her art over time. In reaction to things that were going on around her, some elements creeping into later pictures, all of it becoming. In her letter, we see anger, righteous indignation even. I love how she quotes a psalm, because the psalms in our tradition are the exact spot for anger and righteous indignation. I would bet that if I asked you to name your favorite psalms in this room, we would get psalms about calm waters and peaceful shepherds, and they're good. They're beautiful. And yet, to truly live, the psalms are a book that allow, even celebrate, anger to be poured out in unjust situations. They call for a life that is real and lived in the midst of everything life can throw at us. So the fact that she quoted a psalm as she was writing a psalm was pretty poetic. The psalm that was picked for the opening reading for this ceremony is no ordinary psalm. It is Psalm 150. It is, in the Protestant canon, the final psalm of psalmody. It is the ending. But if you ask monks in monastic traditions, they will tell you that it is the ending that only allows for a breath before a new beginning. For you see, the psalms are encountered from 1 to 150, not as a way of finishing the task, not as reading War and Peace or conquering something, but rather as an invitation to start over again. And Psalm 150, with all this notion of praising and all this notion of music and joyful sounds, you see, it is both a culmination of the Psalms and a new beginning. It is to say, take everything that you have ever learned, and when you start over, do it with praise. In other words, do it with such joy that overflows from you that you do everything the next time around even more fully, even more deeply, even more powerfully. I never really got to know Margaret, but I feel like I have through the stories. And I think the way that this service for me comes together is the invitation not just to honor Margaret today, but to bring this together and to see how that Psalm 150, to hear how that letter, to watch how her art is always an act of becoming and reaching an ending, only to start over again, cognizant of all 149 psalms that went before, and ready to encounter life again with greater joy, with greater fullness, with greater ferocity. Friends, we are about to tell some stories. We're about to bring Margaret back and fully present here in this room, as I know she already is. As we tell those stories, may it be a new beginning, one full of praise and joy. And now will you rise to your feet as you're able, and we are going to sing an absolutely gorgeous hymn, What Wondrous Love Is This. It is number 85 in your hymnal, We will sing verses 1 and 3. Be seated. I'd like to now invite Sam to come forward and offer the eulogy.
That was a tough one to follow. Margaret Northrup was an exceptional person, the most extraordinary person I have ever met. I'm sure everyone here has a story, or 12, that expresses her individuality. Something so beautiful that no one in your life has ever said, or done, or even considered. We can share these stories later today, but right now I just want to give you a short synopsis to help you place yourself in her timeline. Margaret White was born in 1923 in Holliston, Massachusetts, to George and Helen Cotter White. Holliston was rural then, when cars and sprawl had not yet taken over. She was the third of 8 children, grew up in Holliston, and went to Mass College of Art in Boston. When World War II broke out, she joined the Army Air Force. Her skills were best suited to being a draftsperson, which brought her to MIT after the war. Being at MIT proved momentous. While there, she spent time in a music listening library, where she happened to meet a young man named Gordon Northrup. In 1948, they got married, moved to housing in former Army barracks in Chicago, and started a family, first Anne, then Ellen, and Daniel. They were still in the Army barracks. They followed a medical internship to Sausalito, California, where Benjamin was born, in the house on Alema Street. In 1960, still following Gordon's medical career, they moved to Stockbridge, Massachusetts. A few years later, after a few years renting a lovely house on the stream, they bought the giant house on Devon Road that we all know so well. just in time to have one more child, Sarah. Most of us have memories of Margaret in that house, organizing, in a unique, beautiful, and completely inscrutable way. I was born in the barn behind that house, the first of many grandchildren to grow up with her magical presence in our lives. Margaret got to know three of her great-grandchildren, Sloane, Ian, and Stella, though Celine, Felix, and Anissa, whoever will follow, did not get to meet her. She's handed down to all of us, in the middle generations, some of her ability to see the world as it should be, rather than how it is. It's up to us to pass on this unique gift. We miss you, great big grandma, but you've taught us well. Thank you.
There will be time for storytelling in the reception that is about to unfold. Chance for all of you to share whatever stories you have. To warm up for that time, we're going to have just two of those stories told here. I want to invite Diana and Nick to come forward and share those stories.
Well, this was beautiful. Thank you, everybody. We celebrated Margaret's life during COVID. She died in 2020 when COVID was raging and we were afraid to sort of have a thing like this. So it's beautiful that we were able to have it now. I've edited what I said there and I'm just gonna share it with you guys now. As her body aged, her spirit seemed to grow younger. I know it is strange to say of a 97-year-old woman, but when she passed away, it caught me by surprise. The doctors said she didn't have long, but how could that be? Her wish at her last birthday was that everyone could be as happy as me. She was 97, and she was brimming with joy. That is not the wish of someone nearing the end. That is the wish of someone with an abundance of life left in them. She and Gordon created something magical at 4A Devon Road in Stockbridge. A mother, a grandmother, a great big grandma, a friend, an alto, and among other things, a matriarch of our family. But I wonder also how the grass saw her, upon which she treads so gently, as if wanting to spare them her weight. I wonder what the birds called her as they nested in the trees she protected and ate the seeds she provided. I had the sense that she was of this world, but also that she lived beyond it. She was attuned to other parts of life that we in our hustle and bustle too often forget. The beauty of the flowers, the nuance of birdsong, the way light creates rainbows if given the chance, the way calendars repeat in 28-year cycles and also 6 and 11-year cycles sometimes. It's a surprisingly complicated mathematics, but Margaret always knew. In one of our last conversations, I told her that July 5th was the due date of her newest great-grandchild, and she immediately proclaimed in her frank enthusiasm, a Sunday. It was true. She passed before he was born, less than a month, but I will make sure that Hero knows how special it is to have her as his great-big-grandma.
Hi, everyone. Good distance? As we've heard through many voices, Margaret was someone who saw life everywhere in everything. My mom called her an original mind. She marched to the beat of the birds. Notably, if you or anyone were a guest in her kitchen, she wouldn't cook you a roast or spaghetti and meatballs. What she would do is position you at the table, facing towards the window instead of with your back to it, so that you could experience the view of the birds alighting on the porch. And as you gazed out the window, in an instant, she might have disappeared, leaving you to explore and be at peace, perhaps the best gift a host could give. In this way, Margaret gave us all pieces of herself, glimpses of her perspective. I remember Sam proudly displaying a note in Brooklyn that she had written on one repurposed side of a butter box. We all had items like this from her, poignant or cryptic messages shared on pieces of things you never thought to reuse, let alone appreciate. But how could you not love a greasy piece of cardboard when adorned with her signature shadow letters? And in this work, she seemed to whisper to us, "This has more life left in it, more to give." And around her, everything came alive, bouncing with possibility. Every flower on her property, every leftover in her fridge, every calendar saved, every food scrap delivered to Farmer Dave. In 2015, soon after Gordon died, I came to live with Margaret for the summer. I wrote down little anecdotes like this. Sloan, eating a hard-boiled egg on the porch, yells to her father, "I don't like this, it isn't good." Grandma offers, "Have you tried it with mayo?" At the time, Margaret was looking back on her life and wondered if life would have been richer with more religion in it. I recall that she had issues in her relationship with the church that were difficult to reconcile. So I asked her, "Didn't you have trouble with the idea of sin?" She responded, "Yes, I do. People said they went to confession to get clean, but I never felt that way. I guess I'm just a bad rebel." "You're not bad," I countered, to which she replied, "A good rebel, then." She was a good rebel. Her rebellion was one of nonconformity and joy, of acceptance and appreciation, a way of living that celebrates the aliveness and goodness that abounds everywhere.
We are to rejoice and enhance one another's joy. And in moments of sorrow, we are simply to be there and endure that as well. Today, we have shared stories about Margaret. We have laughed, we have cried, we have seen her art, heard her words. That will stay with us, always. In that room, there will be stories to tell. And yet now, we have learned that it is also our job to let go. To let go and to let God. To let Margaret's care now be handled by one who has received her spirit already years ago. And where I hope she is being a great rebel even now. So I ask you, would you rise to your feet as you are able? And would you become like Paul as one body by joining hands with whoever is near you. And then will you join with me in a time of prayer? Holy and loving God, we give you thanks for Margaret. We give you thanks for her life and her gifts. And we give you thanks that you have received her spirit and have welcomed her with open arms. It is into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your faithful servant, Margaret. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a daughter of your own celebration. Receive her into the arms of your mercy and into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and finally, into the company of all the saints in life. Loving God, be with us as we pray the words that Jesus taught us to pray, saying out loud and together, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We are going to close with a hymn, I Bet You Know. And yet, a hymn that Margaret wasn't quite satisfied with. We're going to be singing Amazing Grace. Oh, sorry, before that. Before that, we missed Pat's song. So why don't you have a seat? Would you come up and offer that? Totally up to you. So our closing hymn is Amazing Grace. And you'll notice in the first line, if you look in your bulletin, it's Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved not a wretch. Margaret wouldn't have a wretch there. But instead, simply saved someone like me. In that spirit, will you rise to your feet and let us sing.
Amen.
queue in the reception waiting to unfold. And now receive this blessing. May the peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, which bests our greatest dreams and assuages our deepest fear, may that peace go with you and abide with you. May it uplift you and strengthen you. And may it just hold you in its loving hands. Friends, go in peace. Go in love. Play a little bit more music, which will give the family a chance to just take a breath and go in there. So if you would remain for just a moment and the family might get ready to welcome you, that would be great. Thank you so much for being here.